Well, good afternoon, everyone, or morning, whenever you may be watching this. My name is Evan Alexander. I'm the youth pastor here at Thomas Creek. And now that we've started meeting back together in person again, it is so much better than videos to be able to see people face-to-face again and get to worship together. And so if you're able to, I'd love to have you with us. But for some of y'all, I know it's not a possibility yet due to certain other concerns of sickness and other things. So as we are starting to meet back in person, doing these videos online, and so over the course of the last few weeks, we've started to look at some very basic things about being a disciple. Now, the reason we're looking at some basic things is because before every athletic season, as I mentioned the first week, usually you come into an athletic season not at your best condition, not in your best physical condition. So they do something called conditioning, where you run a lot, you do a lot of exercises, a lot of things just to kind of get your body back in tip-top shape. And so while we're looking at very, very elementary seeming things concerning the Bible and being a Christian and other aspects of that, why we are looking at these very elementary things is because it's almost a sense of spiritual conditioning. After many months of not being able to meet together and having other parts of our life become more time pressing and more sensitive, it's just important for us to look at the basics so that we can be in our top spiritual condition moving forward, which is why we're starting with, what is a disciple? That's just a question. What is a disciple? And we've established over the last few weeks, a disciple is a follower of Jesus that puts Jesus first, that loves God above everything else, and then loves others. And so we looked at some very specific aspects of what that love looks like. Today, we're going to look at something else that a disciple shares everything. One of the reasons I'm excited about getting to meet back together with students is getting to see students serving. Over the last few months, there's not really been a lot of ways for students to be involved in serving through the local church and really even in our local communities. Lots of opportunities that were usually there are not there. And so now that we're starting to meet back, actually tonight we're getting to have our praise team start back up. So some will be singing, some will be playing instruments, some will be running slides in the back of the youth room, some will be helping with sound. And so there's different places that people are getting to start to serve. And the why I like that so much is what we're actually looking at today. A disciple shares everything. If you've been around for quite some time, not really, but this makes me feel old, you may recognize something like this. It is a VHS, a video cassette. Now, these are things that are outdated. They were replaced by DVDs, then replaced by Blu-ray, then they've been replaced by streaming capabilities. And so it's very dated technology. But many years ago, in the mid-1980s, a new technology was on the horizon. It was these video cassettes, these VHS cassettes. As many companies were developing this new technology, there were some that kind of rose to the front. You had Beta and VHS. These are kind of two competing different softwares that were trying to get in on this action. Well, here's the thing. VHS was a technology that was developed, and it was shared for many other companies to kind of work with and use. Sony had developed Beta, and they essentially kept the technology to themselves. Well, after just a short time, Beta started not being used very much, and everyone was using VHS. Essentially, they abandoned that technology because they had kept it to themselves and no one else wanted to use it. Well, in much the same way, when we're looking at our own faith, looking at our own responsibilities as Christians, when we keep it to ourselves, it doesn't actually do what it's supposed to do. When we keep our faith, when we keep our relationship with God to ourselves, when we keep these things to ourselves, it never fulfills the promise that I guess the satisfaction that we're guaranteed as Christians to have. So when we're looking at this idea that a disciple shares everything, understand this, that we've been given everything by God. And when we hold on to it for ourselves, we'll never reach the point that God intended for us to be at when he blessed us with in the first place. So a disciple, essentially at the beginning of all of this, shares everything. That's your time, your talents, your treasure, and your testimony. And that's what we're going to look at specifically here. Each of those points, your time, talents, treasures, and testimonies. We're going to look at each of these parts and seeing how we give this back to God and give it for others. James 1:17 is kind of a theme verse. It's going to, I guess, underlay the rest of our conversation. James 1:17, this is what James writes. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. So it essentially becomes easier for us to give when we understand it wasn't ours in the first place. It wasn't ours in the first place. So we're going to start looking at this idea just with our time. A disciple is someone who gives or shares their time for the glory of God. So one of the greatest resources we have, just in understanding this, is time. There's 168 hours in a week, and everyone has the same amount of time. No one has like a time machine that actually gets you more time. I remember this scene in, I think it's like the third Harry Potter movie where this really nerdy girl wants to take lots of classes, and so she uses this little device that allows her to have more time in the day to take more classes. I know that's exactly what all of you students want to do, take more classes as you're starting back to school this week. Definitely not. But essentially, that's fake. That's fake. That's make-believe. That's a fairy tale. No one has extra time in their day. Everyone has the same amount. Everyone has 1,440 minutes in a single day. That's 24 hours. We each have 10,080 minutes each week that we choose how we use. Unfortunately, though, we don't often treasure the time that we are given. I tried to make a quick little graph because everyone loves educational materials. But just looking at this, the average high school teenager spends 9 hours sleeping each weekday. I miss the days of getting 9 hours of sleep a day, but actually on the weekends, I think the average is like 11 and a half hours. Like, those days are long gone when you're an adult. So the average high school teenager gets 9 hours of sleep every weekday. They spend about 7.5 hours working on school stuff. They have about 4.5 hours of leisure. That means that it's like video games, exercises, some that is comprised of extracurricular activities, things you do like on your own time, usually about 2 hours of screen time a day, like on your cell phones, looking at social media and stuff. Spend about an hour a day eating, 45 minutes a day getting ready. Guys probably spend significantly less time. I know some guys that barely even put on deodorant. So that's just an average. Spend about 16 minutes a day working, 9 minutes a day volunteering, 2 minutes a day on religious activities. I guess that's like blessing your meal before you eat. That's about all you can fit in 2 minutes. Then other is like another hour. So that's like traveling from places, getting in the car and doing things that are kind of dead time. So when we're looking at the average day, each of us choose how we spend the time that we're given. But what does it mean to give God our time? What does it mean to give our time to God? Well, it means that we prioritize our relationship with Him and that we're willing to do what He needs with our time. Giving God our time means prioritizing our relationship with Him. I was thinking the other day, just think about this for a second. If you are in school, or if you have a child that's in school, if you're a parent or someone else is watching, think about how far behind, like if they're a baseball player and they get to be like in 11th or 12th grade and they're starting to look at colleges and stuff. Like, think of like how far behind in their sport they'd be if they didn't play travel ball, didn't play fall ball, didn't play all these other seasons, if they didn't receive all the extra coaching, if they just kind of skipped by for several years and they just started trying to be an athlete. Well, that doesn't make sense. I mean, anyone who has any investment into athletics or into that lifestyle, that world of extracurriculars, they know it takes a lot of your time. It takes a lot of your priorities, a lot of your focus, just to try to hone in your craft and get better at it and be the best that you can be, so you have a better chance of a scholarship and going to a college and all these things. It takes time to do that. Well, in much the same way, I wish that we would kind of think in the same parameters when it came to our relationship with God. I mean, think about how far behind you'd be in your walk with Christ if you just coasted by for 4, 5, 6 years of your life. Maybe you come to church on Sunday, but during the week, there's very little of your life that revolves around you being a Christian and trying to grow as a Christian. I mean, think about how far behind you'd be as an athlete. Think about how far behind you'd be as a Christian. I mean, things like basic things that God expects of us, like us being charitable, being loving, having confidence and assurance of our faith, being able to reconcile how we as Christians see good in the midst of an evil world and have joy in the midst of so much suffering. These are real things that impact our daily activities and our daily mindsets on a daily basis, but so often we neglect and neglect and neglect. And whereas in other areas of life, it's unacceptable for us to be that far behind in our Christian walk, man, we're infants. So what does it mean to give God our time? It means to make him a priority. It means that in our daily lives, in our weekly lives, we are spending time with Him, growing and developing our relationship with Him. It means devoting ourselves to Him and growing to know Him more every day. It means making church a priority because that's the place where we get to worship Him, get to fellowship with others who are like-minded, get to be engaged in serving and being active in our faith through the local church. Sometimes just giving God our time means being available. I mentioned the first week that God likes fat Christians, people who are faithful, available, and teachable. Just being able to say yes, God, and not be so, I guess, scheduled to where you miss these opportunities. Just being available is so important. So looking at how so many of the people in the Bible were just available and God used them in a spectacular way. Think about Noah. Noah in Genesis 6 through 9, he was a man that God had chose to preserve the human race through. So he called Noah and said, Noah, I want you to build an ark. Likely, as most people believe, there had never been rain during that time, before that time. So he's supposed to build a boat in the middle of a place that had never seen rain, and because God was going to flood the earth. And Noah actually did that. He was available. He said, yes, God, I'll do this. And it took him many, many, many years to actually build this boat. And in that time, I'm sure there are people that called him crazy, that said this was a waste of time, that said this was not going to be profitable. But in the end, Noah did what God called him to do, and God blessed him through that. Moses, he was another character in the Old Testament, another figure in the Old Testament. He didn't plan on confronting Pharaoh. In fact, he spent about 40 years of his life running from the call that God was going to inevitably place on his life. He spent about 40 years growing up in kind of this secret life, and then he spent 40 years running from it, and then he spent 40 more years actually being faithful to God. So Moses, he didn't plan on going against Pharaoh, but God called him, and he was obedient, and he ended up leading the Israelites through the Red Sea that parted. He led them almost to the Promised Land. He gave God his time. Paul, a figure in the New Testament, who wrote much of the New Testament, about a third of the New Testament, Paul was a man who spent literally many years of his life defying the Christian faith, going against the Christian faith. But instead, when God calls him and called him out on the Damascus Road, he gave his time, his life to him. 1 Corinthians 10:31, it's a wonderful verse to memorize. It says, so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. So just ask yourself this question, how am I going to give God my time this week? How am I going to be available? How am I going to make myself be available to him this week? What are some things I may need to carve out and put aside so that I'm available for God? Like I said, there's about 2 hours a day that we spend on our cell phones, 4 hours in leisure. Perhaps even we can go without 9 hours of sleep and just get 8. As an adult, you'll probably get about 6 to 7 on a really good night. So these are things that we can cut out of our lives and spend more time being available for God. So a disciple shares their time. A disciple also shares their talents. There was a Spanish philosopher many years ago. He wrote of it's called an aqueduct, essentially an old-fashioned plumbing system that carried water from one place to a city and throughout. And so there was this big aqueduct that was used for about 1,800 years. It would carry this cool mountain water to a hot and thirsty city. Well, nearly 60 generations of people used this aqueduct. Well, finally, they had newer technology, and they decided, well, let's retire this aqueduct. Let's not use this anymore, and let's use this newer stuff. But let's respect it. It's such a marvel. Let's preserve it as a museum piece. Well, they did. They laid these iron pipes. They gave the ancient bricks and mortar a rest. And not too long after, the aqueduct began to fall apart. The sun beating on the dry mortar that was not carrying water anymore, it made it start to crumble, and it started to fall apart. And in a real sense here, as soon as the aqueduct, the plumbing system, stopped being used for its primary purpose, it started falling apart. Well, think about our own lives for a moment. Many of us have been given such great talents that when we don't use them, it makes it to where our lives don't quite come together and reach the point it was designed to be at. I think of so many people that have wonderful singing voices they'll use their singing voices to sing in the shower, to make jokes with friends, but they never actually use it for the glory of God. And it's just this talent that seems wasted in the background. People who are good with their hands, and people that are have other abilities that they just don't use them. And it makes it to where we're wasting our talents that God has given us with. Essentially, think of it this way. Everyone has something they're good at or something they are able to do. And this is a phrase I like to use. Find out what you're good at and do it for the glory of God. If you're wondering, how do I give God my talents? Well, find out what you're good at and do it for the glory of God. No matter who you are, you have something you can give and contribute to the kingdom of God. Find out what you're good at and do it for the glory of God. A disciple is called to share their talents. 1 Peter 4:10, this is what Peter writes. Each of you should use whatever gift you've received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. I love opportunities we have like the Back to School Bash, where It's an opportunity for us to collect school supplies and donate it to people, but also in a different sense, you have people that also cut hair. You have people that are good with finances, that are budgeting everything. You have people who are good at organizing, that are able to get everything in line. You have people that are good at haircutting, and they that's what they do as a job. So you have people using their talents for the glory of God. Think about for your own life, what are you good at? Find out what you're good at, and then find a way to do it for the glory of God. There is some way that you can contribute to serving other and using your glories for God. So a disciple shares their time, shares their talents, further shares their treasures. Just in such a beautiful way. Just think about how you live your life. Now, likely many of the students, at least in our church, many of them don't have jobs yet. They're middle school and not quite driving yet and other things. And so probably you don't draw a paycheck, but if your parents make, you know, around $32,000 a year, which is, you know, pretty standard for a full-time position around this area, at least, they're richer in the top 1% of people who make money in the world. That sounds crazy, but I remember being in Haiti just a few years ago, and we were buying t-shirts and notebooks from a child, essentially, that was making these crafts and different things at the area where we stayed. And so we were buying these things. They're like, yeah, we'll spend $10 for a t-shirt. It wasn't a big deal, but a dollar was the average daily wage for a worker in that part of Haiti. A dollar a day. And here we were just paying $10 for a t-shirt. And so the guy that was with us is like, stop. This may seem cheap for you as an American, but for someone here, this is more money than they're used to. And so be careful with that. Lots of negative things can come along with that. So in that, it just changed how I started thinking. Now, there are people in the world that make less than a dollar a day, and that's how they provide food for their family. So in all of this, just think about how blessed we are to be where we're at, to have the opportunities we have. That's a big blessing. But a disciple, we don't just keep all the stuff for ourselves. We are blessed so that we can be blessings to others. Disciples share their treasures. A disciple doesn't hoard their wealth or take their treasures and put them under their mattress. A disciple generously shares their blessings with those around them. Think about the early church in the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 2, verses 44 and 45, Luke records, all the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold their property and possessions to give to anyone who had their need. So they weren't instructed and forced to give their stuff. It's not like someone, the phrase today is not like someone held a gun to their head and made them do this. But out of the grace that they had received from Christ, they felt it their responsibility to help others in need. So as disciples, as followers of Jesus, we have what we have because we've been blessed by God with that. And in that, we've been blessed so that we may be a blessing to others. A disciple shares their treasures. So often, just a basic principle we use in the church is the idea of tithing. Essentially, that's the idea of giving God 10% of what we make. We give it back to the local church. And then if you look at, now I know most people don't come to budget meetings at churches because it may seem boring, but if you look at what a church gives and what a church does, we as a church, we give a good percentage of our what we receive from people who are faithful in giving back to the church and giving to God. Much of what we give ends up going to support local ministries, to support local people that are trying to or help those who are in need, like those who are struggling with addictions or can't provide food for their family. We have a benevolence fund that will support people or help people that can't pay power bills or water bills or rent. We send money to our larger area of cooperation. It's called the Georgia Baptist Convention or Mission Board now. In that regard, we are giving to things like the Georgia Baptist Children's Home that takes care of fosters and orphans. And we are giving to many other ministries that are supported through that. And then some more money is going toward the North American Mission Board that is supporting churches being planted and other local ministries, and Send Relief that supports like disaster relief, and whether it's hurricanes or tornadoes and that kind of stuff, they come in and provide help in the rebuilding process of that. So a lot of the money people just give to the local church, it goes to local ministries, it goes to state organizations, it goes to these larger scale North American and even international, the International Mission Board that we give money to, that they support so many different ministries all over the world, so that people not only may hear about Jesus, but see the love of Christ in that. So in that regard, we not only see that when people just give to the church, but if you think about it for a second, there's other moments in the church where we give graciously. whether it be the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, the Annie Armstrong Easter offering, where we give money to support missionaries all over the world. Even it, like with the World Changers mission trip we did last year, there were dozens of people in our church that personally paid for some people to go and serve Christ and be a missionary for a week. And so in that, we are blessed by God so that we can then be a blessing to others, so that we might not only experience the grace of God ourselves, but we may share that grace of God with other people. So in that, a disciple shares their treasures. Finally, a disciple shares their testimony. There's a story in Mark chapter 5 where Jesus, he had fed the many, many thousands of people. They got on a boat, ended up in Gerasenes. There was a man there that was possessed by many, many demons. So the demons were like legion. There's so many of them in him. Well, Jesus casts the demons out. They jump into pigs, and that's part of the story. But this man, his life was radically changed. He had been possessed by demons, and Jesus had freed him from that possession. And so this man was like, Jesus, I want to go with you. I want to follow you. I want to be where you're at. Like, my life is different because of you. I want to be where you're at. And Jesus is like, whoa, now, stop. I want you to stay here. And how he explains it is essentially, look, man, like, you have a testimony now. How your life has been changed by the encounter you've had with me. People who know you and see this difference, they're going to know I'm for real. And so he encourages them, stay where you're at and just share your story with so many others. He recognized that his testimony was going to be a powerful tool for him in sharing the love of Christ with others. Think about your own life. Now, granted, so many, at least that grow up in the church, they give their life to Jesus so early to where I would hope as a 12-year-old, you probably didn't get into like to alcoholism, into the party life. I'm assuming as a 12-year-old or 15-year-old even, you probably didn't go out and perform these heinous acts of evil. So I would hope that your life before Christ probably wasn't so bad. But each of us understand this reality that before Christ, where were we going? To a place called hell. No matter whether you're a teenager or you're 50 years old, whether you haven't lived that bad of a life or whether you have committed so many sinful acts, like on the same field, we are going to the same place. So in all of that, we see that though we may not have had a bad life, we have a testimony of where we were at before Jesus. We know what Jesus has done for us in sending his only son to die on our behalf so we might have forgiveness of our sins because that debt's been paid in full. We have life in him because he now lives. And so in that, we have a story of what who we were, what Jesus did in our lives, and who we are now. I would hope if you've experienced the saving grace of God, you're no longer the person you used to be. And if you are, then perhaps there's some other things we need to be looking at in how you are still living in your old ways. And perhaps you never really gave your life to Jesus in the first place. That's something to consider. Because when we're looking at this here, we understand that God changes lives when we encounter Jesus. And when he changes our lives, we then have a testimony or a witness or a story of how God has changed us. And most likely, if people around you knew you before Jesus, I'd hope they'd see the difference too. Perhaps if we don't look that different, then there's some room for growth in our lives. So what is a disciple? It's the question we're looking at. A disciple puts Jesus first, loves God above everything else. A disciple also loves others. That was week two. But finally, a disciple shares everything. A disciple shares their time, shares their talent, shares their treasure, and shares their testimony. If perhaps there's an area of your life that you're struggling in, I want to encourage you, how can you be available to God this week? How can you start to share more in your life? What are some things that perhaps you need to cut out of your life so you have more time for him? What are you good at? How can you do that for the glory of God? What has God gifted you with that you can share with others? How can you share your story of how Jesus has changed your life to the vast many in our world that do not understand the joy and the hope of the salvation we have in Jesus Christ? Those are lots of questions, but it's all surrounding this idea. A disciple shares everything. What do you have to share this week? I hope you have a wonderful week. As everyone's starting back to school, I hope God is just protecting you and your family, and I hope that you trust him and that you're sharing everything he's blessed you with. You're sharing that with others. Thank you so much. God bless.